Before we get into some questions, I just wanted to give you the opportunity to tell the voters about yourself and why you're running.
My name's David Holden, candidate for Congress. This is my second race. I was the 2018 Democratic candidate in 2018, of course. And I have been involved in the life of the community my whole life. My parents were very active in the civil rights movement and in standing up against the Vietnam War. So, you know, I thought protest rallies were play dates with my mom. And they were both active as scout leaders. My dad was my cub master. So that was just kind of the air we breathed at home, which was you take care of others. You lend a hand where needed. So that's been a really important part of my life. And after my wife Streeter and I moved down here full time after the 2016 election, I just felt, and she agreed, that we were on the wrong track. And I didn't want to just sit at home and yell at the computer screen. I wanted to get involved again.
Let's talk about the issue that's clearly at hand at this point, which is the coronavirus. What, if anything, should the U.S. have done differently in response to this pandemic? And what should the country do in the future to better handle this virus or another one like it?
I mean, I don't think we have time to list all the things that the administration in Washington did wrong, starting with disbanding the pandemic response team that started under President George W. Bush, where we were not just prepared in this country, but we were actively engaged with allies and countries that weren't necessarily allies around the world to be prepared to respond to an emerging pandemic. We knew that there was a good chance that we were gonna have this sort of experience again in our lifetimes. So undoing that, as President Trump did, that put us at a tremendous disadvantage. And then the ongoing inability for this man to tell the truth about virtually anything that doesn't reflect well on him. So we've been fighting self-serving speeches with science and medical advice, and you know, only literally in the last 48 hours has there been some sense that he gets it and that perhaps he's going to change his behavior.
Healthcare is important at all times, but especially now. The Affordable Care Act still exists, although it has been shrunk compared to what it originally was. What are your thoughts on how to make healthcare better, especially dealing with rising medical costs, which is a concern for American families?
Yep. So I think ultimately we have to get to some form of universal healthcare. But we start, it's not something that can be solved overnight. Even with a new president and a Democratic Senate and somebody new in the House, this is a huge part of our economy. It's about one-sixth of our economy is built into the healthcare system. So we start by undoing some of the damage done to the Affordable Care Act. And some of that can be done by executive order, and some of it can be done by legislative act in the House and the Senate. So I think we start there. One of the things, you know, the Affordable Care Act was by no means perfect. I think it was the best that we could get at the time, but it did a wonderful job of insuring Americans and in bending the cost curve downward. So we've got to continue to fund it and expand it, and we have to encourage states like Florida to take advantage of the Medicaid expansion.
Let's talk about jobs, because the pandemic did a number on unemployment. We're in double digits at this point. What, if anything, do you think can be done to accelerate a recovery that some economists think could take many years to take?
So much of our economic recovery is going to be based on when we get our arms around the pandemic, which clearly we haven't. Certainly not anywhere well in this country, and in Florida, we're going the wrong way. But we're going to have to do some things first to support working Americans and families through the crisis. I think we have to look at the things that Canada and Great Britain have done to make sure that families have enough income to pay their bills, to keep a roof over their head and to feed their families. And we're also gonna have to invest, you know, we call it on my campaign, building a new American dream that's more equitable. We have to make sure people are getting a living wage. We have to make sure that people have paid sick leave. Again, we have to make sure that people have not just access to high quality healthcare, but get that high quality healthcare on both the dealing with issues as they emerge and on the wellness side. So the minimum wage, if the minimum wage had just kept up with inflation from the mid 70s, it would be $24 an hour.
Let's talk about an issue very specific to Southwest Florida. A couple years ago, we had a water issue in the summer. Water quality was a big problem. What, if anything, do you think you can do as a congressman from Southwest Florida to help in that situation?
So it's, you know, our campaign was going on through both of those, the red tide and the toxic algal bloom. So I learned a lot. And one thing we have an abundance of in Southwest Florida is really smart, experienced people who come to live here. So I learned a lot and I experienced a lot myself. And in fact, if you look at the way Congressman Rooney voted in his first term and his second term, he's like a different guy. Like, he got it. He saw what was happening and he responded. So with this district, the 19th district, isn't the environment is our economy. We run entirely along the Gulf Coast. It is why people come here. It's why they live here. It's why they spend their money here. So the quality of our water and our air is essential. So we have to do several things. We have to admit that climate change is real. We have to follow the science there. And we have to, you know, the response is mitigation and adaptation. So we have to make, as a nation, we have to make major investments in mitigating and adapting to climate change.
I'm not going to tell you something you don't know, but this is a historically conservative district that tends to go 60, 65, 35, 40 in the elections. Understanding that you're running a Democratic primary at this point, right, what do you say to conservatives in Southwest Florida who see Democrats as a threat to their rights and they fear big government? What do you say to them?
What I've been saying throughout my life. So throughout my life, I've built bridges across difficult boundaries in my business life. I'm a retired financial planner. My wife, Streeter, and I had a financial planning practice that she still is running. And so I'm a business guy. I care about, you know, the markets. I care about freedom. So I'm not talking about changing any of that. I'm talking about making sure that the playing field is a little bit more balanced so that people, young people, especially today in Southwest Florida, have the opportunity at the American dream that I had and that my generation had.
Continuing along the same thing, where do you stand on gun rights?
So I am I'm a strong supporter of the Second Amendment. My wife and I are law-abiding gun owners. When it was pre-COVID, one of the ways we unwound from the campaign was to do some target shooting. She's much better than I am. And in fact, I was trained in riflemanship as a Boy Scout by the NRA. So I'm a strong supporter of Second Amendment rights, but I'm also a gun sense candidate designated by Moms Demand Action because I think there is a huge consensus in support of some common sense gun law reforms, which include, you know, universal registration, ending the loopholes on background checks. We want to make sure that gun rights are protected and that people are kept safe.
If you're elected from this district, you would go to Washington and vote on others' ideas, but you'd also have the opportunity to offer your own. What is a unique, original idea that you have that you think could make Southwest Florida or the country a better place?
So, you know, you look at this district from afar and you see a bunch of retired people, and there are a lot of retired people here, including myself. But this is a vibrant community of families who are here to raise those families to make sure they have the best possibilities for their lives. So my focus is going to be on providing top quality public education and to make sure that students, when they go on to college, have choices, not just college, but vocational training. We have in Naples the headquarters of Arthrex, and we lost several hundred jobs to South Carolina because we didn't have the workforce training and the workforce housing to fill those high-paying, career-based jobs. So I'm going to focus on that.
What's the biggest threat to the United States on a foreign policy level?
Well, I think it is our surrender of leadership on the global stage. President Trump has been emboldening our enemies. Vladimir Putin is an enemy of the United States. He is hot and cold on China. China can be a partner, but they also have very different geopolitical goals than we do. Our system is based on freedom. Theirs is not. So I think we're going to have to reestablish American leadership. Europe, NATO countries are looking to us, and we're simply not meeting the need.
Where do you stand on illegal immigration and that issue?
Well, I'm against illegal immigration, but I think we have to acknowledge that across the country, we've got 12 million undocumented people here. In this district, if undocumented people disappeared tomorrow, this place would come to a halt. So we have to have the kind of bipartisan immigration reform that President Reagan signed into law in 1986. I think we have to accept that folks that are law-abiding, that are paying taxes, that are working hard, should have a pathway to citizenship. And we have to make sure that we protect the Dreamers, and we have to also make sure that we protect the TPS countries like Haiti.
Would you support a national E-Verify system that puts the onus on employers to check immigration status before hiring?
You know, I think E-Verify can be a two-edged tool. I think we want to make sure that we verify people who are working here, but we also have to be cognizant of the fact that the system has been used to harm folks who are essential workers, right? If we learn nothing in this epidemic, it's that the people working to produce our food, to clean our homes and our communities, they're essential workers, and they have to be given some respect. So I want any move towards a national E-Verify to be part of a broad-based bipartisan immigration reform. This is a critical election. We're going to decide the future of this country. You can say that every year, but this year it's true. I strongly believe that electing Joe Biden president is going to get this country on the right track. I look forward to working with him starting in January.